room. I'm so glad everyone's here. Amen. Let's all play. Let's all begin to clap our hands. Amen. We're going to sing this song, Days of Elijah. Amen. We're going to invite the presence of the Lord into this place. Let's sing.
And these are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sword. And we are the voice in the desert, crying, preparing the way of the Lord. Sing, behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, lift your voice, the hero jubilee. Out of Zion to salvation.
Sing that next part. These are the days.
And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. These are the days of a harvest, the fields are as wide in your word. And the labor is in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Sing, behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, lift your voice, it's the hero jubilee. And out of Zion's hill, sing it again. Behold, behold, he comes, shout it out, church, shining like the sun. At the trumpet's call, lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee. And out of Zion's hill, sing it again one more time, church. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. And at the trumpet, sing it out, church. And out of Zion's hill, sound one more time. Behold, behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, yeah. At the trumpet's call, and lift your voice, it's the year of jubilee. Out of Zion to salvation.
Come on, church, lift your voice in this place. Let's give him the praise that he deserves in him alone.
Beauty, you
that again, church. One thing I am.
One thing I ask, and I would say, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells.
Better is one day, Lord,
for better is one day in your peace. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand elsewhere. And better is one day in your course. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course.
Let's sing it out again. Better is one day in your course.
And better is one day in your course. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand.
Sing that again. Better is one day.
Better is one day in your course. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand.
Better is
one day. Better is one day. Better is one day.
Again, church.
Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day.
Sing it out again. Better is one.
Better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day.
Sing the chorus. Better ways one day.
And better is one day. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand.
Shout it out, church. Better is one.
Better is one day in your course. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your course than a thousand.
Better is one.
And better is one day. Better is one day. Better is better is one day. Better is one day. Better is one day.
Come on, church, if you believe that tonight, give him praise and worship.
We worship you, Lord. We praise you, Father God. Robo Siri ara la babo bobo. Ira ara la babo bobo. Hallelujah. Shiri di 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 baba bobo bosa. We love you, Lord. Amen.
Amen. And the reality is, one moment in God's presence, we're going to forget about everything else. So one moment in God's presence, it'll all be changed. Amen. And that's, God gives us a taste of that here on this earth. And we can have all sorts of things going on. And yet we just get in the presence of God and we find strength. We find joy. We find what we need to be in an overcoming state. And that's where we're at today. God's going to help us as he helped us this morning. He's going to help us tonight. He's going to help us for this week and strengthen our lives for our future. Let's pray. Let's ask him to speak to us a fresh word, an invigorating, encouraging word that's going to work his will in and through us tonight. And we're going to pray. Let's also remember tonight we've got Pastor James and Pamela Quinn down there in Ingleburn. They have a revival with Pastor Evangelist Corey Bourne. Let's pray for their revival, for great things to happen there. And let's ask God to help us here tonight. And when we subside, I'm going to ask Ben if you could lift up your voice and open us up in prayer. Father, we worship you today. We thank you for the Holy Ghost. We thank you for your presence. We, God, delight to be in your presence, and we want you, Lord. We want to walk with you. We want to experience you firsthand and to know you and to do your will. God, help us, Lord Jesus, tonight. Refresh us and strengthen us and equip us, Lord, for all that is ahead for our lives. And God, we're asking for your blessing on Pastor James and Pamela Quinn, for the revival with Pastor Corey Bourne. Help them, God, encourage them, strengthen them. Let the work of God continue in that place, and great prosperity there, Father. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Hallelujah. We can be seated tonight. It's a great joy to be in church again, to see you here for our second Sunday service. And we're going to have a good night, and we'll get to the Word of God in a minute. Just a reminder, again, Wednesday night we have our midweek service at 7:30 p.m. If you can get off early enough and come here at 6:30, we do have prayer beforehand, and so you can come. Be refreshed personally in God's presence. Prepare your heart before the service, and God will help you. So that's Wednesday night. Saturday we have the Battle of the Bands audition in Fairfield, and I encourage you to be part of that and see the good things God's doing in the various churches' lives, and the disciples there rising up and doing something for God. And then, of course, our Sunday services again next week. Okay, so good things happening again. Look forward to the Sydney conference that's coming up pretty rapidly. And that's going to be a sensational time. If you can get the time off work to be there during the day seminars, you won't be disappointed. And, of course, if that's not possible, there's also the evening services each night, and some fantastic speakers. That's all the announcements. I'm going to ask Justin to come to take up the offering tonight. Let's just give God praise. Father, we worship you, we adore you, we thank you for your grace. Hallelujah. We get a chance to give into the kingdom of God again. I'm going to ask Justin to pray over the gift and giver.
Father, we thank you, Lord God, that we can come back into your house. Father God, we're praying, Lord God, we're thanking you for the provision, Father God, over our lives. Father God, it's an honor, Lord God, to partner with you at this time, Father. Lord God, that our gifts and our givings, Lord God, will be pleasing to you, Father God. We're praying, Lord God, that you would help us, Father God, to give with a cheerful heart tonight, Father God. We're praying you bless the gift and giver in Jesus' name.
Amen. The Lord bless you as you give.
And I've got my mind made up to serve the Lord. And I've got my mind made up to serve the Lord. And I've got my mind made up serve the Lord. Lord, I've got my mind made up.
Hallelujah. Amen. Appreciate that song, team. And let's go to the Word of God tonight. And we're going to go to John chapter 2 this evening. John chapter 2. How many of you here like a soft drink or a fizzy drink? It's not a trick question here. I'm sure at some stage of your life, at least you ran to the fridge like me, and you looked if mum or dad stocked it up with some Coke or some fizzy drink there, and you dived into it if you saw it. My wife likes to have a Pepsi Max, and I admit I do too, and she likes to crack open a can, twist open the cap, maybe if it's a bottle, pour it into a glass with some ice and some lime in, and we'll enjoy it. But there's something about a fizzy drink, and when you first open it, you start pouring it in, and then you kind of have to stop because there's so much fizz, and you got to let it settle down, and then it fizzes up again. And it's always funny when you see someone open up a can or a bottle that's already been shaken up, and they open it up unwittingly and it all spills open and goes all over the place. And so it's the fizz, it's the carbonated water in there, the carbon that they put in there. And the opposite of that is true, where you can go to drink what you think is fizzy drink, and if it's not fizzy, it's like, oh yeah, I didn't ask for this. That's not what I was expecting. I was expecting a bit of fizz, a bit of bubbles there, and some life in it. And so many times, I don't know about you, but I don't like a soft drink that's lost its fizz. And I share all of that to say that, you know, life can sometimes be like that. That we can start out full of fizz, if you like. We can start out full of life, full of energy. There's exhilaration, and there's effervescence, if you like. But time passes, and after we've been exposed to the elements, and we live in a fallen world, of course, there's our own struggle with our fallen nature. It's very easy to lose the fizz. And we can lose the joy, we can lose the effervescence, we can lose the excitement, we can lose the enthusiasm and that sparkle of life that makes a difference. Amen. And what happens is we can become dull, we can become stale, we can become very flat, right? And it's not what a good way to be, is it? Right? And especially as Christians, that God has put in us the fizz of life, if you like. He's put his spirit in us that we would be flowing over, that we would be full of life. And God says that he can give us his spirit. Out of our belly will flow rivers of living water, right? And so there's this expectation for the believer to be just, my cup is overflowing, right? There's fizz in life. And yet the way life happens to us, we can often become very flat. And in our text, there's a wonderful occasion of a wedding going on. And apart from salvation, there's probably no greater day than when you get married. And that's how it ought to be anyway, right? Two people celebrating their big day. It's an occasion for great joy. In the midst of it, though, there's this very real threat of it becoming a great embarrassment to this couple. And Jesus was able to save the day and save this couple from potentially an ongoing embarrassment that they would have had to live with for the rest of their lives. And he was able to turn the water into wine for them. And so I want to look at this tonight, and I've called this sermon Restoring the Fizz. And I want to say to you tonight that God can restore the fizz of your life, that sparkle. If perhaps you feel like you've gone flat, you've gone dull and stale, God can restore that, the life again. Let's look at this from John chapter 2, from verse 1. The Bible says, on the third day there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding, and when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Now there were set there six water pots of stone, according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the master of the feast." And they took it. When the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom. And he said to him, "Every man at the beginning sets out the good wine, and when the guests have well drunk, then the inferior. You have kept the good wine until now. This beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him." Amen. So let's look at this, restoring the fizz. In the days and the setting of our text, a wedding was a really notable occasion, and the wedding celebration lasted for more than one day, right? They would often go for a full week. The ceremony itself took place late in the evening after a feast. After the ceremony, the young couple were conducted through the village streets by the light of flaming torches and with a canopy over their heads to their new home. And they were taken by a longest route as possible so that as many people as possible would have the opportunity to wish them well. But a newly married couple did not go away for their honeymoon. They stayed at home, and for a week they kept open house. I don't know how that would go down these days. Imagine the newly married couple after being dropped off at their home. They want to say bye at the door, and then everyone rushes inside and just says, what's for food? Put on some fellowship for us. And they're thinking, are you going to go home now? And so in those days, that wasn't the way. It was like, well, you know, it's hospitality, and that's the way it was. They wore crowns and they dressed in bridal robes. They were treated like a king and a queen. They were actually addressed as a king and a queen. And in a life where there was much poverty and constant hard work, this week of festivity and joy was one of the supreme occasions. And so when I think about the joy of this occasion, I can't help connecting that with how we begin in life so often. For children, life is full of fizz, right? Everything is new. Life is filled with constant discoveries and with new experiences, with new sensations. They're stumbling upon new things every day. Everything's, wow, I haven't seen that before. What about this? Mum, Dad, did you see that? New sounds, new sights, new smells, new tastes, new feelings. Life is a buzz. There's a lot of fizz in life with all of these new things. And, you know, I've seen kids taste some soft drink for the very first time, and it's like they put it in their mouth and it's like, you know, the whole thing is just amazing for them because they kind of taste the sweetness and the bubbles all at once. And once they work it out, you know, they've scrunched their face up. But then it's like, give me some more. I like this stuff. This stuff's good stuff. They want more, whether it's a new toy, a new bike, a new ride, a new friend, a new stage of life, fun times, friends, food. You're just loving life with all of these new experiences. Might be when you discover the person that the person you like, who happens to like you. Again, there's more fizz. When that leads to the altar, more fizz. When you discover you're having a family, more fizz. Life is spilling over. Good things are happening. It's unfolding for us. What about when you get saved and you discover God's grace for your life and His acceptance and His forgiveness and His mercy? When you've been released, perhaps into ministry the first time, you know, it's like a whole bottle of, these Mentos have been dropped into a Coke bottle. If you've ever seen it, the thing just starts spilling over. The life becomes amazing. You taste of the things that God has for you the first time. And it's effervescent. At the beginning of our lives, life is generally full of the things that excite us. And so this couple in our text was in full swing in their celebrations. And Jesus had no problems being with them right there. He was happy for them. He wasn't a killjoy. He rejoiced with them. C.H. Spurgeon wrote, "I commend cheerfulness to all who would win souls. A genial, happy spirit. There are more flies caught with honey than with vinegar, and there will be more souls led to heaven by a man who wears heaven in his face than by one who bears hell in his looks." And so here's Jesus. He's happy. He's happy to be there to rejoice with them. The truth is, Jesus has come to give us life and life more abundantly. It was His idea for you and I to have the fizz in life. to be going, wow, and oh, whoa, I haven't seen this before, and to enjoy a fullness of life. And I believe heaven's going to be very much like that, where day after day, moment after moment, we're going to be stumbling into the amazing things that God has done in eternity. It's His idea. Let me say, marriage was His idea. He created it to bring more excitement to life, to open up more wonderful experiences, as in our text here. And so God has created the fizz of life and all of these things that bring it. He wants us to have life and life more abundantly. Life, though, can take a turn, can't it? This couple was on the verge of experiencing some serious humiliation, whether they knew it or not. We can only guess whether they knew it or not. The wine had run out. What's the significance of this? One Bible commentator, William Barclay, said, "For a Jewish feast, wine was essential." He said, "Without wine," said the rabbis, "there is no joy." It was not that people were drunken, but in the East, wine was an essential. Drunkenness was in fact a great disgrace, and they actually drank their wine in a mixture composed two parts of wine to three parts of water. At any time, the failure of provisions would have been a problem, for hospitality in the East is a sacred duty. But the provisions to fail at a wedding would be a terrible humiliation for the bride and the bridegroom. And so this is the situation there. And if you know any Middle Eastern kind of people, many Europeans, that whole element of hospitality, and I'm sure in many other cultures there's that element of, hey, we've got to have enough food and we can't dare run out. And it was a sacred duty for them. And what we do know, though, is that the waiters and Mary, the mother of Jesus, they did know about the fact that the wine had run out. There are other ancient writings that suggest Mary had something to do with the arrangements of this wedding. And it appears to line up with the Bible record here, because Mary had knowledge of the problem and was worried when she found out that the wine had run out, and she had to do something about it. And we know she took the problem to Jesus in verse 3, and when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And so you have to put yourself in this situation. Imagine you've put on the big do. It's your wedding day, right? The venue's booked, the decorations are set. Everything's in place. The guests have come. There's food, there's drink. People are having a good time. And then suddenly it's like their cups have run empty, and it's like, "Can we have some more wine?" And the waiter comes and says, "Yeah, I'll get you some." And off they go, and then someone else calls for it, and someone else calls, and it's like the waiters are not coming back. And there's a delay. Where are they? Before, they were coming very quickly, but now what's going on here? And people are starting to get thirsty. Where's the drink? And so here's the waiters. They're stressing out. We're being asked for all this wine, but there's nothing left. What are we going to do? This is an embarrassment here. This is a serious problem that we have here. And so in their desperation, they go to the person who helps organize it all and say, "We've run out of wine. Have you got any more? We need some more." And so who did they go to? They went to Mary, the mother of Jesus here, right? And I doubt that she would have taken that to the newlywed couple and said, "Hey, guys, you've run out of wine." Right? I can imagine she would have tried to fix the problem before they even knew about it. And so somehow she had to fix this problem. And this is a picture of what life can turn into. Everything can be going swell. Everything can be in full swing. And yeah, we're having a good time, and this is good, and that's good, and I'm enjoying this, and there's fizz in life, and there's no problems, there's no shortage, there's no contentions or fights, there's blessing all round on all fronts. But something crucial then begins to run out, and suddenly this issue just creeps up on you. And for this this couple, it was the wine, right? For this party, the wine had run out. And for us, do you know what the wine is? I think it has a lot to do with the presence of Jesus in our lives. When the presence of Jesus runs out in our lives, think about that. You might not know Jesus. He might not even be a part of your party. But you know what? The wine will run out sooner or later, and there's only so far you can go before you realize, I need the wine of God's presence in my life. I can't function. He's the vine, and I'm a branch, and without that connection, I'm going to dry up, right? It's not possible to live life apart from Him and without eventually shriveling and dying. And let me also add that Jesus, as a saved person, Jesus may be at your party. He can be in your life and be part of your life, and you can run out of joy as well. Even as a saved person, you can run out of the joy of His presence. You can run out of that which is vital. You could lose the joy of your salvation. You could forget what a wonderful thing it is for you to be right with God and have His forgiveness, and that joy is like lost. You could lose the appreciation of His presence in your life. You could take for granted the many blessings that He has given to you. You could look at your wife. You could look at your children. You could look at your godly parents. You could look at the many possessions that He has blessed you with. You could look at the place He has given you in His house to serve Him, and you could lose the fizz. You could just forget the value of God's presence and what God has actually done in your life. And what happens? We lose enthusiasm. We lose excitement. There's no joy or gratitude. Everything becomes dull and stale and flat. And so that's a terrible place to find yourself in. Can you say amen tonight? If something doesn't change, the sweetness of your celebration, of your life, it's going to turn sour, right? Something has to change. We've got to somehow get the wine of God's presence back into our life. It's a beautiful thing for us to read that Mary knew where to turn in this desperate situation. And we read that she took the problem to Jesus. See, if you've lost the fizz of your life, if you're no longer excited about life, if you're no longer excited about being saved and being a Christian, a child of God, if your enthusiasm and your joy and your appreciation has taken a hit, right? You've got to do what Mary did and go to Jesus personally, right? He can be at your party. He can be in the vicinity, but you're going to have to approach Him and say, we've run out of wine, Jesus. Amen. It's not good enough that He just be somewhere around your party. You have to have a personal encounter with Him, and you've got to allow Him to act on your behalf and bring a restoration of His presence, His wine. Amen. Mary approaches Jesus, and at first glance, it appears that He responds roughly to her. Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." And again, we read that in the English, and we think Jesus is being rude to His mother. No, He's not being rude to His mother, but we have to understand that just the something is lost, changing it from the Hebrew, so well, in this case, because it's the New Testament, from the Greek into the English, when that change of language happens, and also the cultural element from the Jewish to the English, it sounds to us like, yeah, so what? That's not my problem. I've got other things to do. Right? Sounds like He's saying that to her. What's my your concern have to do with me? Right? But the actual original words, there's a gentle tone in the words. It was spoken kindly. It wasn't spoken with reproach to His mother. It was more like, my dear lady, don't you worry. You don't quite see what is going on. Leave it to me. I'll sort it out. And it was more that kind of response. And Mary understood that. We don't read about her getting offended or anything. She just knows Jesus is going to do something about it. And she says in verse 5 to the servants, whatever he says to you, do it. Right? So his response was, I'm on to this. Right? I'm going to do something about it, my dear woman, my dear mother. That kind of attitude. And so the servants heeded Jesus. They listened to what he said. They were told by him, you go take those 6 water pots that were there that were used for the Jewish ceremonial washings and stuff. It was normally filled with water, and that had been used. Go and fill those 6 water pots of stone with water. They were 20 or 30 gallons a pot. Let's say an average of 25 gallons to find the middle ground. That would equate to about 114 litres a pot. 6 pots would have been close to 700 litres, right, of water filling those pots. And so they filled them up and they brought it to the master, and the master tasted and he realised, man, this is good. So think about this. Jesus has done this amazing miracle, creating 700 litres of the best wine for them to continue on having the celebration of a lifetime. They were going to do this. 700 litres, that's roughly 350 2-litre bottles of Pepsi Max or whatever else you like to drink. That's a lot of bottles of drink, right? That's a lot of... He's fully supplied it right at the end. There's not going to be any shortage of it. And so the master was amazed after he sampled the water, and he said in verse 10, every man at the beginning sets out the good wine, and when the guests have well drunk, then the inferior wine. You have kept the good wine until now. In the Phillips translation, it says, everybody I know puts his good wine on first, and then when men have had plenty to drink, he brings out the poor stuff, but you have kept back your good wine till now. And so think about this. Here's Jesus. He responds. There is a serious need. The wine had run out. The joy had run out. The fizz of the party, if you like, had gone, but he was able to abundantly restore what was missing. And think about this. It only took a bit of basic obedience to trigger the miracle. It took a woman to say, Jesus, I need you to intervene in my situation. I have a serious lack here. This is no small lack. And she goes to the right place. He tells the servants, fill up the pots with water. Now, it's true, it's a little bit of a task to fill 6 large water pots with water. And obviously, because of the situation, there was an urgency there. But this wasn't a complicated ask from Jesus, right? It wasn't some too difficult task. It was just do this basic task. Go and put water in the pots, bring them back. That's all it was. Nothing complicated. There's a little bit of urgency about it, but it needed to be done, and they did it. And you know what? Sometimes Jesus just tells us some basic things so that fizz can be restored in life. So that the presence, his presence would be restored. Little things. Church is on. Make sure you're there. Don't drop the ball with your attendance. Don't see church as some light matter, but you just keep coming. Keep coming and entering into my presence. Get up, seek me first thing. Open my word, let my truth fill your mind. Again, these are simple things. Read your Bible, pray, come to church. Lift up those hands and praise me. Simple things. He didn't ask you to climb a mountain. He didn't ask you to lift 500 kilos over your head. He just said, lift up the hands that you have to me and begin to worship me. From your heart, forget about what's going on around. Just begin to set your eyes on me and worship me and just enter into my presence. Just do that. He might say to you, just come kneel at the altar at the end of the service, and he speaks to you through the service. Just come and kneel in my presence and trust me with your heart and pour your heart out to me in that place. Let me touch you at the altar space. He might say that to you. He might ask you to trust you with your finances, that you would trust him with your finances and so forth, right? Just these are basic acts of Christianity. This is not, you know, SAS style Christianity. It's just the basic level Christian. Just do the basic obedience things, right? Baseline acts of obedience. The difference is, though, doing them in faith rather than as a mundane task. You get what I'm saying? So you can come to church, yeah, church is on and I'm there. You can open your Bible, I've got to read my Bible and just tick off another chapter. You can enter prayer like that. You can come to the altar like that. You can worship like that. And many times we can do the routine things and leave out the critical thing of the faith element, that I'm connecting with God, that I'm trusting God through this act. I'm actually engaged in this routine, and I'm not disconnected from the moment, but I'm very, very present in what I'm doing. Now, when I'm worshiping, I actually am worshiping. When I'm at church, I actually am having church, and so on. Amen. Do you get what I'm saying? It's basic Christianity, but you're doing it in faith. And it's like, God, there's a surrender of your heart and your spirit right there, right at that moment. And you know, when we do that, God can't help but making the water into wine in our lives. And we can feel, like I said, very dry or very plain, or it's like we're feeling flat and dull. But the moment you make a connection with God and you engage your faith with your Creator, what did that woman say when she reached out and touched Jesus, right? What did Jesus say? He said, I felt power go out from me. Something happens when we engage our faith with the routine things that we know, basic Christian practices, and God can do a miracle. God will work a miracle and turn the water into wine. The fizz was more than restored. The celebration continued. Jesus saved the day. He saved the couple from humiliation. He saved this couple from embarrassment. You know, they weren't the important people of the world. It wasn't some big worldly occasion. They were just a simple couple getting married, but their life was important to Jesus, not only to be part of it, but to maintain the joy of it and to create for them a wonderful memory where he worked that first miracle there in his ministry. For all of us here tonight, you know, he views us no differently. We are very, very important to him. He wants to enjoy with you the celebration of your life. He wants you to have life and life more abundantly. You are a big deal to him. Amen. You really, really do matter to him. And when it looks like you've run out of the fizz and you've lost the joy and the exhilaration of life, you only need to call on him to help you. And you can be assured that God always leaves the best for last. Just when you think, I've seen it all in God, God begins to show you something greater, something more. Something I've got more that you don't know about. And he always leaves the best for last. The best is always ahead of us. And he wants to restore the fizz in our lives when we lose it. I want us to bow our heads this evening, and we're going to close in a word of prayer. And a very simple message about God wanting to restore life to us. I did mention earlier that life has a way of taking the joy out of our lives, and we can lose the passion and the zest for life, and life can become very routine and mundane and joyless, no sparkle anymore. I want to tell you, God wants to restore that. It begins through your surrender, through you saying, Jesus, forgive me, I'm a sinner. I've been trying to do life my way, and I need you tonight. I need you. I cannot do life without you. And you might be here this evening and you need to surrender to Christ. And if that's you, if you'd raise your hand, we'll pray a sinner's prayer with you. Amen. If you want Jesus Christ to come into your life, forgive you of your sin, and restore the abundant life, give you abundant life, that this is for you tonight. Is that you? You'd put your hand up. Amen. Is that you, brother? Is that you? Do you want to receive Christ? Amen. Come forward. Come forward. We'll have someone. Justin will come and pray with you tonight. Amen. Just come down to this altar space. Justin will pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I want to speak to all of us here tonight without re-preaching the message. Have you become dull and flat and stale in your Christian walk? Have you lost the fizz of the Christian life? Have you lost the fizz of God's presence? Amen. God wants to restore that. He doesn't want you to be dull and stale and flat and see Christianity and living for God as some boring endeavor, some lifeless, mundane thing. He wants to restore. He wants you to have joy. He wants you to have life and life more abundantly. But it just doesn't automatically come to you. You've got to feel the lack of it. Do you feel the lack? Do you feel it enough to say, I'm lacking, I need God? Do you feel it enough to go to Jesus personally? Not just be around Christian circles and have Christ around you, but do you feel it enough that, hey, I need to personally go to Christ? Jesus, I'm flat, I'm dull, I'm stale. I need you. I need you to turn the water into wine. He gives you some basic things to do. Don't stop doing those basic things, but do them now in faith. Do them being engaged. When you pray, pray. Don't be distracted. When you're at church, put your whole heart and mind in the experience. When it's time to worship, when it's time to do anything for God, any service that you do, let it be with your whole heart and with an attitude of, God, I love you and I need you, and without you my life is meaningless. I need you to restore your life in me. I want you to turn the water of my life into wine again. Restore the joy, Lord. Restore the passion. Amen. We're going to open this altar space, and if God is speaking to you, I want you to come and find a place to pray and ask Him to do those things I've been speaking about. Hallelujah. God wants to help you tonight. God wants to help you. Hallelujah. It's not necessarily doing more, but it's doing what you already do for God with faith, with engagement. Hallelujah. God wants to help you tonight. My God, we love you and we need you tonight. You are the joy of our lives. Father, apart from you, my God, what joy is there? Father, what life is there apart from you? God, I'm asking you to refresh the hearts of your people. Help them, God, not to fall into a dullness of spirit, a staleness in their lives, that they would not be, and we would not be flat, Lord, in our faith. Help us. Restore to us the joy of our salvation. Uphold us with your generous spirit, my God. Help us, God. Fill us afresh with your presence. Help us to be full of you, God, and that we could teach sinners your way, Lord. Touch each one of my brethren here tonight. Touch us. We want, God, your power to come forth from your throne and do a mighty work in every one of our hearts. Restore the joy. Restore the fizz, God, of our faith. Touch your people. Let them have gladness in your service. Let them be joyful in your presence. Oh God, let us wear heaven on our faces, God. Yala makia la mashikia, because it comes forth in our hearts. Shala bala la baba shi bala la makara la baba shi. Help us, Lord. Help us. Shala la makora la baba la baba shi. Touch us, Jesus. Touch us, Father God. Hallelujah. Shi bade 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 de baki ya la babu bobo. Hallelujah.
Remember, remember mercy. Christ before me, Christ behind me. Your loving kindness has never failed me. Christ before me, Christ behind me. Remember love, remember mercy. Christ before me, Christ behind me. Your loving kindness has never failed me. Christ before me, Christ behind me.
As you finish, I want you to stand and begin to sing this song tonight. Let's begin to worship you.
Every moment I need you. Hear now this graceful heart sing out your praise forever. And Jesus, I need you every moment. I need you. And hear now this grace-poured heart sing out your praise forever.
Remember love.
Remember mercy. Christ before me, Christ behind me. Your loving kindness has never failed me. Christ behind me, Christ behind me. Remember love, remember mercy. Christ before me, Christ behind me. Your loving kindness has never failed me. Christ before me, and Christ behind me. And Jesus, I need you every moment. I need you. And hear now this grace-poured heart sing out your praise forever. And Jesus, I need you. Every moment I need you. Grace-poured heart sing out your praise forever.
Let's give you our praise tonight, Jesus. We worship you, Lord. Ebora lo kora la ba 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 ba. Ora ba 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 re be 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 le be 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 she. She la re be 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 le be 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 sha ra ba bo 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 bo. Hallelujah,
Give God praise. Jesus, we worship you. We praise you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. He can make our cup spill over. Amen. And he doesn't run out of his Holy Ghost. He doesn't run out. He gives his Spirit without measure. And it's on us to be going to him and say, God, I'm thirsty. I'm thirsty. I've run dry. And I need you to fill me afresh. Amen. God has the ability to turn a very plain life that we can live and turn that into wine. Amen. Water into wine. And he'll never disappoint us tonight. I appreciate you being here. And I really am trusting that you had a personal encounter with Jesus tonight that strengthens you. Amen. So we're going to close in a word of prayer, and I'm going to ask Compton to seal us off, and we'll send us
Father, we thank
God's
you
blessing. Hallelujah.